Good afternoon. My name is Randall Reed Smith, and I serve as Governor Justice's Commissioner for the West Virginia Division of Culture and History. We are happy that you could join us today as we continue a time-honored tradition here at the Capitol Complex, the unveiling of a governor's portrait. And now, it is my honor and my privilege to introduce to you the 36th governor of West Virginia, the inspiration of West Virginia, Governor Jim Justice.
Between Joanne and, if I could call him Earl Ray, you know, they spent almost three quarters of a century, you know, in public service for us. Their absolute love for West Virginia is noted. And just by the fact that so many are here that are friends, that love them, it is a really, really, really special day. Now, I'm not going to cloud all of the hoopla because there's a lot that's going to be said here that is way more meaningful than what I can say. But I can tell you this. I had many, many meetings with Earl Ray. I considered him a friend. I considered him a friend long, long, long ago. Now, not only was he a friend, but he was someone that had vision and someone that really cared. At the end of the day, you know, that's what it's really all about. It's about us that care about who we are and try to perpetuate the betterment of this state. Now, you just think. Think about all the accomplishments and all the things that Joanne did. Well, the one that just touches my heart the most is her service at a technical school, a school that was teaching our people trades, teaching our people to become our workforce. And she did it forever and ever. She represented us as First Lady of this state in a fantastic way. And it gives me the honor beyond belief to be your governor and to be and have the opportunity to give these good people just another sprinkle of their due. You know, that's the bottom line. At the end of the day, it is an incredible honor to give good people their due. You know, I would bet my life on this that Earl Ray and Joanne both never really wanted anything for them. And absolutely, that's exactly where I am. So I can't possibly honor them with anything anymore than just to say, thank you for being who you are. I love you as friends. I love you as West Virginians. And I love you for the fact that really and truly, you did one thing that was incredible, and that is you served. You served without an underlying reason for yourself. And I love you for it. So that's all I got for this moment. Now I'm going to just sit here and introduce now the great ex-First Lady that'll be First Lady forever. And that's the beautiful Joanne Tomlin and everything that's given us so much in this state. And she's going to get up and she's going to speak and she's going to do great stuff. So let's give her a big round of applause.
And thank you all for being here today. We have such a wonderful crowd, and people have fared the terrible weather today. They've come from far and near, and we just want you to know how much we appreciate it. We have family here. We have former legislators. We have friends that are new. We have governor's staff, former governor's staff, and friends that we've had for many, many years who have supported us through 42 years for the governor being here in Charleston. So thank you all for being here, and especially thank you. Our son Brent is here with our daughter-in-law Brittany and my father-in-law Earl Tomlin and my nephew Paul. Choosing an artist with the help of our dear friend Commissioner Randall Reed Smith and his staff, who we have appreciated dearly for many years, who have helped us through so many events here while we were in Charleston. We were so excited to find out that we had a wonderful option right here in our own backyard. Nejun Chong is an associate professor of painting West Virginia University. And after earning his Bachelor of Fine Arts in oil painting from Nanjing Arts Institute in his homeland of China, Professor Chong received his master's degree from WVU. He has since joined their faculty as an associate professor of painting. He has had solo exhibitions at O.K. Harris Works of Art in New York and Michael Berger Gallery in Pittsburgh. He has been included in exhibitions in a number of places in both the United States and China, from New York to Florida. He has been part of exhibitions at the Huntington Museum of Art and here at our Culture Center on the Capitol grounds. Professor Chong helps connect our state with his homeland. And as the lead faculty member of the School of Art and Design Summer Painting Study Abroad program in China. On a personal note, I can tell you that Professor Chong has been wonderful to work with, and we're so fortunate to have him as part of our great state. And I will tell you that some people are born with the gift of God, and I will tell you that this gentleman is born with the gift of God. He has an amazing talent. He is quiet and unassuming. We watched him take five tiny little paintbrushes with a few bristles on them, which he'll probably demonstrate for you, and turn canvas into a masterpiece. And for this, we are eternally grateful. So thank you, Professor. So now, it is my pleasure to introduce to you Professor Chong, the artist who painted the portrait of Governor Earl Harvey Tomlin.
Everybody, please make welcome Governor Earl Ray Tomlin.
very much. Glad to see that the Senate adjourned for this spring. President Carmichael went back in the room. But it is so good to see so many of you who have played such an important role in my life. It's just, I'm amazed that you're all out here, and especially with the way the morning started out with snow and ice and being Groundhog's Day. I certainly do appreciate you coming from all over the state, to be quite honest with you. And you've really made a real difference in mine and Joanne's life. I want to recognize just a few people here. You're fortunate when you go through 6+ years as governor, just to have, fortunate to have one chief of staff. I was fortunate enough to have two great chiefs of staff. My first one, Rob Alsop, is here. My third one, Chris Stableman, is here. My other one is with his grandbabies down in Georgia, so John Lawrence. So anyhow, we're pleased to have you here. We're very pleased to have our Secretary of Education and the Arts and the 35th First Lady.
Yes, thank you.
You may want to get those numbers out and figure out how it's working. But anyhow, I'm also very pleased to have my dad Earl, my nephew Carl, my son, and our newest member of our family, Brittany, with us here today. And you know, Rick grew up in this life, and you know, it's always been in public office. It's tough sometimes, but he's handled it well, and obviously, you know, he's doing really well. I'm proud of all of him, so thanks for being here. And this might be one of my last official or quasi-official actions in the governor's reception room, Governor. And because, I, as you know, I don't hang around here much, but my portrait will be hanging around here. And I also want to give thanks to Joanne for all that you've done over the last 40 years, not just me and my family, but the people of West Virginia. You not only have been my partner, my biggest fan, but you've helped lead the way for changes in our community and technical college systems that continue to benefit students today. A couple of your initiatives you had as First Lady, I know has made a difference in the lives of a lot of West Virginians. And that first one being the Baby Safe and Sound. And I think for those of you who don't know about the program, it's basically how to teach babies sleep and the way you take care of newborns. And I'm sure because of the work that you and others have done, you've probably saved hundreds of babies' lives in West Virginia. And also want to thank you for all your work with veterans issues. I know that you worked very closely with our National Guard, and appreciate those programs. looking back through our so many legislators I served with, and it's just good to see all of you just over around the world. Professor Zhang, I want to thank you for your beautiful work. I'm just amazed that somebody can look at something in their hands with a brush and do what he's done. And then I thank you for your dedication to our state and to your students at West Virginia University. And I'm so pleased that we were able to find a world-class artist right here in West Virginia. We appreciate you. I'd like to just tell you a little story. Some of my staff used to kind of get a kick out of this, that as most of you know, I came here right out, a fresh, newly graduate from WVU, and then when I was first elected to the House of Delegates, I was the youngest member of the House back in those days, and you know, I don't think a lot of people took me real seriously, because they weren't used to a 22-year-old would be running around, but I was younger than that. But I remember being sitting in the chamber one day, because this is back before the legislators had offices. Your desk was your office, so you know, when you had a break, anybody would sit around. But there was a group of the older guys, it's probably in their late 20s or early 30s, talking about signing up for the state pension plan in PERS. I didn't know they had a pension plan when I first got here. So I got to think about it, so I went over to see this elderly clerk that we had at the time. A couple days later, I said, "Mr. Blankenship, am I supposed to come in and sign up for retirement?" He looked at me and said, Boy, don't worry about it. You're not going to be around. But anyhow, I just can't tell you what an honor it is to join the ranks of the great governors who have served our state. And most of you who know me or have worked with me know that I appreciate the tradition and our state's history. And as well I should, since I've served during at least a quarter of our state's history. Think about that. Somebody mentioned that to me the other day. We talked about 42 years. Our state's just about 160 years old. That's about a quarter of it. I've been under this dome here. So where did time go? I don't know that. It's been so rewarding to be part of so many great accomplishments during my tenure as both a legislator, finance chair, Senate president, and now the 35th governor of the 35th state. And we've certainly had our challenges, and they continue today, Governor, but we've come a long way since a 22-year-old walked over the stove with lots of hair and a little scraggly mustache in this beautiful building. And for one, I'm pretty sure that Governor Justice can appreciate some of the financial decisions we made, because I remember the day, Governor, with the return of the gas off of the governor's mansion many years ago, because we couldn't pay our gas bill. So luckily, we're not in that position today, and things are looking up in West Virginia. I'm so pleased about that. We've also been able to make some changes over the years. If many of you in this room have played big roles in it, when we had the medical malpractice crisis, we were able to keep our doctors from leaving the state. We fixed a broke workers' compensation system, and we've also put ourselves on a path to pay off our long-term pension liabilities. We were able to cut taxes to help our citizens and create more jobs and work to diversify our economy with projects like Rock Creek Development. Just as much to me. Lifelong friends of so many of you here today, among my fellow legislators and cabinet secretaries, I see most of those who served with me, constituents, our staff up at the Senate, when I was Senate President and in the governor's office. You know, we've got wonderful stories. We've had laughter and tears, successes and struggles. And all we've achieved, we achieved it together. With Democrats and Republicans, women and men, young and old. And so much of what we hear today focuses on our differences and personal attacks. And I hope that we can all remember what unites us as a people, as West Virginians, is much stronger than what divides us. So walking through the halls of the Capitol, you see portraits of governors from both parties, from different generations, with different strengths, different weaknesses. But I truly believe we have all had the state's best interest at heart. And that's true of today's leaders, but you do too. And I appreciate that. Now, when we started to discuss what my official portrait would look like, I had no idea there was so much to it. The background, what I was wearing, how I was standing or sitting. And when you realize that your portrait will hang in this room for years, and then in the halls of the Capitol for decades or longer, it's a little intimidating. But ultimately, we decided that I should appear as most people would see me, with some of our state's most important symbols in the background. Our beautiful state flag, part of the great seal of the governor, and the stately wood background of the governor's office. Now that office, the place where so many discussions critical to our state's future took place. Landmark legislation on education, economic development, healthcare issues, and so much more. It's where we discussed, and in some case, years ago, we discussed and discussed and discussed state budget. But you may know how that is, but anyhow. You'll get over it. But anyhow, that office, the governor's office, and the conference room next door, is where we would go together to respond to disasters and learn words, new words, like derecho, or superstorm. What the hell's a derecho? Rob, we figured it out, didn't we? Or, at the same room, it's used to plan ways to respond to unspeakable tragedies, such as the deadly flood of June 2016. So great joy has also resulted from actions in that office. And I remember being in there one morning, early in my tenure, Keith Burdett and Chris Hopkins from the development office. As we were on the phone, the senior executives from the stand, we were talking to their CEO in Singapore that morning. And that project was set to go to another state due to the consultant's recommendation, until Keith and Chris and I explained that West Virginia, what West Virginia could do for the stand, and what their jobs meant to us. And with that, their CEO, within just a few days, chose West Virginia and promised at the time to create up to 400 jobs. Those jobs, over 1,000 workers at the stand last year. Good paying jobs. Sees the portrait here just in a couple of minutes, but it reminds me of much more than just the 6+ years that I spent as your governor, over the 17 years I spent as Senate President, and the 42 years total that I served this great state. Instead, think about all that we have achieved together during this period, what we have positioned our state to achieve, and all the great things that to come for West Virginia. It's really been the greatest honor of my life to serve as your governor. And I am forever grateful to the people of West Virginia for giving me that opportunity. So I want to thank you all again for being here today. And God bless the great state of West Virginia. Thank you.
There is a reception in the Great Hall at the Culture Center. Please join us. Thank you.